How's the con going for you?
The con, I just got here.
You just got here?
Like today is this, you are it.
I'm number one.
I've got a friend who's in some movie that's having like a 20-minute screening or preview tonight, so I'll go to that after.
That's awesome.
And then be busy Friday and Saturday.
Yeah? Do you have a hotel room here, or are you driving back and forth?
Nah, just going back and
forth. Okay.
Yeah, I think so. Partly because kid stuff and everything.
Kid stuff. Well.
I've got 11 kids now, man.
You have 11 kids now.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
It's a whole lot. That's crazy.
Logistically challenging, and both of them are co-parenting, so it's like weird schedules, some days nobody, some days half, some days all.
I both envy and don't envy you all at once.
Yeah, it's busy.
Mm.
But in a good way, kind of.
So I am here with the other Brandon, Brandon Mull, author of many fantastic books, including the Fablehaven books and just like a billion other really cool things. Candy Shop War, one of my favorites. We are going to be talking about our five favorite mysteries.
Yeah, that's right.
People get us, they don't do it anymore. I don't know, how long has it been since someone came through your line and thought you were Sanderson?
It's been a while, but it's also been a while since I've had a line.
Yeah.
Because of COVID, you know? But, so from time to time, it still happens, but it used to happen more.
See, it hasn't happened to me in a while. It used to happen all the time, because I think you broke out before I did. And so you were the Brandon that writes fantasy novels, and then I came along as the other Brandon who writes fantasy novels. And it was always tragic for me because it's usually some little kid, right? It's little. I mean, like,
oh,
you know,
yeah,
some like 8 or 9-year-old who's waited in line to see me and then brings up Fablehaven. And I'm like, oh no, not another one of these. Sorry, little kid. I didn't write that book.
If it ever happens again,
yeah,
just fake it.
Just be pretend
like,
to be
oh, that's so great. Like, yeah, I'm so glad we got to meet, you know? Just be nice.
I'm going to be a jerk. I'm going to be like, oh, I can't believe you read that one. I hate that one.
That's right.
So why'd you pick mysteries as your thing you want to talk about? Are you like a big unsolved mystery person?
I am more and more lately. I don't know if it goes with writing fantasy books or if it just goes with the world feels weird.
Mm-hmm.
Lately especially, and so I've just been extra antsy and curious. And I think it's also because I bumped into people that that brought up personal stories of mysteries and stuff. And so, it got my radar up on, like, X-Files type things, you know?
Well, speaking of X-Files type things, like, on your list, by the way, these are five of our favorites. Doesn't have to be in any order, and it's not necessarily that there aren't other favorite things that aren't on this list. No,
yeah,
these are just
true.
Five of our favorite things. One of your favorite mysteries is UFOs, like the granddaddy, right?
Kind
of the big patriarch of mysteries. Why UFOs? What makes you interested?
Here's the thing about UFOs.
Mm-hmm.
If you had talked to me 5 years ago, and said I think UFOs are real, I'd be like, probably not. And then like, I talked to a few people who'd had experiences with UFOs, and like this lady from New Mexico stands out. Like, I was just in a hot tub on vacation, and I was with my wife, Erlyn, and she's always liked mysteries, so maybe that's part of it too.
Mm.
But this lady in the hot tub mentions, oh yeah, I'm from New Mexico, and Erlyn was like, oh, have you seen a UFO? And she's like, yeah, we all know UFOs are real. And we're like, well, tell us some stories. And she told us some stories that after that hot tub experience, I was probably 50% more convinced. I was like, okay, yeah, that was a fairly credible seeming person who had some stories. One of her stories was her father on her deathbed told her son that he saw an alien, that he recovered an alien body with the military. And
wow.
So like that was like, okay, I'll give you points for that. And she had a friend who she was from New York. She had gotten a job with the Forest Service in like some small town place in New Mexico. And the story is she went to a Texaco and all of a sudden everyone in the little mini mart of the Texaco goes outside, oh, they're back. So she goes outside and sees this giant blue sphere hovering over the gas station. And she said the people there were all like, oh yeah, last week it was orange and like stuff like that. Like as if it was very commonplace to them.
Mm-hmm.
And the woman I spoke with in the hot tub acted like in New Mexico, a lot of people have seen very strange things and are convinced it's real. And so after those stories, that put my radar up, where I was like, huh, it like shifted from probably not to, oh, maybe, You know?
I have to say I'm more of a skeptic on these. Like, yeah. I absolutely believe that UFOs exist.
Yeah, right.
In that it's just an unidentified flying something. Right. I absolutely believe that aliens live on other planets.
Yes.
I do not, I'm not convinced that they've been visiting us. At least not in the, you know, the UFO-y sort of way. But I do have that same sense as, like, the fantasy author that, like, I want to believe, right?
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
the,
yeah.
The whole thing from X-Files, right?
Yeah.
I really want to, like, we'll get to some of mine in a second, but another one of yours is Bigfoot. Bigfoot, I totally want to believe that Bigfoot is real. Like,
yeah,
I would love it if Bigfoot was real. To the point that I love watching Bigfoot media. Like, I don't usually watch the UFO media. They're just, the accounts are too varied. But Bigfoot's like a specific thing. Like, there's this thing living in the woods right here. And, you know, like, I don't honestly believe it's real, but I really want to. Does that make sense?
It totally makes sense. I'm a little bit there on all these things, mm-hmm. including on UFOs.
Yeah.
I'm not in a place where I can say I know it's real,
right.
or I have a personal experience mm-hmm. where I know it's real. I just had enough people that smelled credible to me
mm-hmm.
that said stuff that it shifted me to maybe. Because, like I almost said 5 years ago, I would have said exactly what you just said.
Mm.
I would have said exactly the same thing. And that's not saying that you would ever shift.
Right.
But,
oh, I might totally.
But hey, like given the right experiences, maybe right. For me, it like. After I got tipped a little bit on UFOs, once the government put out a few things too, it just seemed like all in succession there was like this little landslide of validations that made me go, huh, maybe.
On the Bigfoot thing,
go Bigfoot.
One of the preeminent scholars on Bigfoot used to be, might still be, a professor at the University of Idaho in Pocatello, one that is, and he had been published by my publisher and editor at Tor just a few years before I was picked up.
Yeah.
And so my editor Moshe was like, hey, read this Bigfoot book, it's really fun. And I just loved that Bigfoot book. And I'm also, it's got like the local connection because my family's from Idaho Falls, which is just up from Pocatello, and here's this Bigfoot scholar. And so I got really into it for a little while, just reading about Bigfoot.
That's cool. So you got a little passionate about that
mm-hmm.
one, huh? I use Bigfoot in Dragon Watch 5, actually.
Mm-hmm.
I finally put it into one of the books.
Which makes perfect sense in that that world and that...
Yeah, Fablehaven, mm-hmm. we're crossing over with magical creatures, yeah. right? And I hadn't really gone very cryptid on it, you know, mm-hmm. like Bigfoot-type stuff, but I finally did it. And part of why I did it was my wife is really curious about it, and,
mm-hmm.
and she got my wheels turning about it, and
mm-hmm.
you know, whatever we think about, we use sometimes, right?
Not sometimes. That's just how books happen. Like,
kind of how it happens, right?
Yeah, I don't know if it happens with you, with your wife, but my wife will read one of my books and be like, hey, I was with you when this happened, and I was with you when this happened, and oh, I remember when you asked me this question that we talked about, and it became this. Like, she can just kind of plot where I was writing a book by the experiences that we had that ended up in the books.
Yeah, that is true and kind of funny. Like, anyone who knows me well sees me and sees moments from my life sometimes in the books, exactly like you're describing.
So I put on my list Jack the Ripper. You didn't put any of that kind of the serial killer sort of stuff. And I am not big into serial killers, but something about Jack the Ripper really intrigues me. In a very morbid way, obviously. I think it's that idea of that sort of turn of the century London, like that 1900s becoming modern era where it's like this person, this ghost from a future era almost. Like it's like mass murders and things are a thing of our era, not of the past era.
Yeah, it's like a total early adopter.
Yeah. And just that era in London is so intriguing from a fantastical way. I mean, I read an entire book series, the Wax and Wayne books, about kind of that era in a fantasy world and things like that. It really intrigues me. I've watched a lot of the Jack the Ripper media, like trying to pick out who is it and things like this. And I mean, it's obviously awful, but I think it's also the fact that it's removed so far. Like, I don't get into Zodiac or things like that. Who is that? But Jack the Ripper gets me, and I always, if I run across something, I'm going to read it or watch it when someone's talking about Jack the Ripper.
There's something moody and atmospheric about
mm-hmm.
it, right? Do you have a top theory or a favorite theory?
No, I really don't, because every time I watch them, like, I guess my favorite theory is the one, there's one of the lords that people are like, oh, it was him. It's secretly a lord, where it's probably not, right? It's probably just, you know, it's probably fairly lowborn. Like, yes, they may have had some skill. They worked in a butcher shop. There's a guy that worked in a butcher shop that was one of the main suspects at the time. Hmm. And it's probably somebody like that. But the more fanciful ones where it's like some lord, like, you know, I've read all the, you know, it was actually an alien sort of stories. I'm sure you've read lots of these stuff like that. And those are all really fun. I would like it to turn out to be like, you know, the Crown Prince or something like that, right?
Right.
But it's not going to. When sometime in the afterlife, when I can ask my 100 questions and get answers, this will be one of the questions on my list, though.
I think that's a fun question. Yeah, I'd be curious too.
Mm. A lot of my other ones kind of play into more historical stuff. Like one of the things I would mystery is, you know, what was in the Library of Alexandria? What did we actually lose?
Yeah,
right?
I would love
like,
that one.
Like everyone theorizes, and one thing about this mystery that I just love is the idea that like we look at, say, the Iliad and the Odyssey and things like this as like they're not the absolute first bits of storytelling that we have recorded, but they're among them, right?
Yeah.
You don't have to go much back, much further before you get the first written accounts that we have, like Gilgamesh and things like this. And it occurs to me, every time I read this, I'm like, this is one of probably thousands upon thousands upon thousands of things written that just had the luck to be the one that ends up in our modern era. And now we look at it and be like, oh, it's the Odyssey, it's the Iliad, which are also obviously awesome, right?
Yeah.
But the concept that is hard for me sometimes to remember, it's like they weren't the Iliad and the Odyssey then. They were just one of thousands of pieces of stories that were written down. They're just the ones we have. And the knowledge that they're just an entire world of fiction and pseudo-fiction, like religious sort of writings that that are more mythology or things like that, existed and then are now gone. Like we don't have, for instance, Socrates, right? We have Plato, who wrote down what Socrates said. We don't actually have what Socrates wrote. And so we just have to trust Plato that he's really teaching us what Socrates actually said. And Socrates being like the preeminent philosopher of the era, and we don't have his writings.
Interesting we have him indirect only, huh?
We only have him indirect as a character in Plato's writing. And some of these things are just really fascinating to me. Like most of what we know about Gaul, right, was recorded by Caesar. Because everything that they would have written or oral legend is just gone. So we only know about this entire culture because Caesar wrote about conquering them.
Yeah.
And just next door, a lot of the Germanic people, we know nothing because Caesar didn't write anything down. He didn't go over there. And the fact that there is just all of this lore and knowledge and all of these stories, like we happen to have Beowulf, like we're so lucky to have Beowulf, right?
Yeah.
But it's just like one scrap of probably thousands. That really intrigues me. I would love to be able to dig into all of that.
Yeah, you want to go back in time, rifle through the library.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Find like, what's your 10th favorite? Ask the librarian.
Yeah,
you know, like,
yeah.
And see, none of these are known.
There's a great story, Romance of the Rose by Umberto Eco, which talks about a lost manuscript. And it's just one of my favorite kind of historical pieces of literature. And it's just a really cool idea to me, lost manuscripts. Like, you know, there's a bunch of Plato we don't have, right? And I'm like, not Plato. There's a bunch of Aristotle we don't have. And it's like, what was in there, right? It's really, really curious to me.
Yeah, when what we have has been studied for thousands of years. You're like, oh, and there was more? There was like 10 other volumes or 3 other volumes or something?
So I talked about something old. Let's talk about ancient giants.
Yeah.
This is, I think, the most interesting one that was on your list. Tell me, like, why this intrigues you. What do you mean by ancient giants?
Okay, so, like, I read this book recently, The Ancient Giants Who Ruled America.
Uh-huh.
It's a nonfiction book, or North America, I think.
Okay.
And if I paraphrase the title, I'm really sorry.
I mean, are they talking about humanoid giants, or are they just talking about, like, giant sloths or things like that, like the megafauna?
This is what they're talking about. Like, they found archaeologists and just random farmers over the course of, like, 100 years in the United States, they found remains of 8-foot dudes. Like,
you're kidding me.
According to this book, and this book, you know, look up the book.
Okay.
I'm not a scholar on this, but
8-foot dudes.
But they found like I'm talking like in Pennsylvania, they find like 50 something skeletons that are like 7.5 to 8 feet tall. They send them to the Smithsonian, and they all disappear. And this happens over and over again. It happened on Catalina Island. It happened it happened in spots all around our country, where supposedly, like, there's newspaper articles mm-hmm. from the day, and there's pictures in those newspaper articles from the day of these 7.5, 8 foot, 7 foot tall clusters of giant remains that were found under mounds or buried, and like weirdly shipped to the Smithsonian and weirdly disappeared, and there's no record, and the Smithsonian says we never received it. And so either it's mysterious because of a giant, enormous hoax,
right?
Or it's mysterious because who wanted to hide that there were giants here,
right?
And like so not we're not talking fee fi fo fum size, but we're talking something that is like an anomaly that seems to have been covered up for some reason, and it's weird.
Man, I would that's another one I would love to be true, right? Because you can relate that to Bigfoot.
Yes,
totally relate that to Bigfoot. Again, I am not much of a conspiracy theorist, right? I think that people are bad at keeping secrets, and I think the number of people who have to be involved to keep some of these secrets would be so astronomically high. But at the same time, I like this idea just because, like, the Bible mentions giants, right?
Right, yeah.
And it's like, who are these giants that are mentioned in the Bible? Why do they call them giants? Not just Goliath, right?
Like, there were races.
But it's like a race of giants, it says in the Bible. And that's not the only ancient reference to this idea of giants. No. Now, part of me wants to say, Norsemen, right? You get somebody who's on average 6 inches taller than you because of various things like this. And, you know,
they might feel like giants.
They might feel like giants. But there's a part of me, it's like, no, I want to believe in giants. You know, that is cool. That's just, it's the sort of thing that we write stories about, right?
Yes, it totally is the sort of thing. And it's the kind of thing that just seeing that book with those articles, it just got my wheels turning, my imagination going. And not necessarily that I'm going to write a book about it, but it did awaken a lot of curiosity. And it totally made me cross-reference biblical giants. Made me wonder, oh, wait, did we ever find skeletons like that over in Israel or over where the Bible happened? You know, I don't know.
One of mine on my list is I would like to see the Colossus. Going back to, you're going to see a theme in the things that I pick. So the Colossus at Rhodes, right?
One of the seven wonders of the ancient world, right?
Like, we don't, like the Colossus of Rhodes, the Hanging Gardens, we don't really know what the Hanging Gardens looked like, if they existed. We obviously know several of the ancient wonders. The Colossus is the one that inspires me, though, because giant statue. Giant statues are cool anyway.
Yes.
Right? Like, even in our modern technology, you go to the Statue of Liberty, you're just like, we built this. And yes, there are skyscrapers that are taller, but
it's so incredibly out of scale with us.
Yeah,
right?
It's a piece of art that the only purpose is to be a cool piece of art, and it's the size of a giant building.
Yeah.
I love that. And I've always, you know, we always imagine the Colossus straddling the harbor. It probably didn't, right? They probably couldn't have done that. But part of me is like, but what if it did? What if they could? What if they could get the Colossus straddling the harbor? What would it look like to actually see the Colossus? Did they build it up against anything? Did they not? Was it freestanding? Like, I just want to see the Colossus. And I want it to be cool. I don't want to get to the Colossus and be like, oh, they were off on a zero on all of their descriptions on the size. Actually 10 feet tall or whatever. And
the pretty big statue by the bay or whatever.
Yeah, that is one of my favorite pieces of ancient mystery lore is the Colossus.
Yeah, I like that. That's a good one.
One of my favorite video games is Civilization. In fact, I listed it number one on my list of video games. And you get to build the ancient wonder. You get to build all the wonders, right? And they do things like you build the Colossus and you get an extra trade route for some reason. But you know, I always like building it and be like, I built the Colossus, and they, you know.
That's really funny. I could see like that would be, just from your list, I could see that would be a priority inside the game.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. I want to build all the wonders. I want to have the most wonderful civilization of all time. And it's like, you know, you walk into my cities and it's like, there's the pyramids and there's the Colossus and there's Broadway. And we just built them all next to
art
each other.
Art and beauty and civility and all that stuff.
So next on your list, ghosts.
Ghosts. So here's the thing with ghosts. Is like, we've got stories in the family. We've got stories you bump into people. Like, ghosts are one of the weird ones. Where if you get into almost any group that's a foreign group to you, if you bring up ghosts, it's odd how many people have got something. It's odd how many people have a story that's either theirs or their grandparents. this was particularly interesting. I was in the Outer Banks in North Carolina.
Uh-huh.
Right? So yep. Hatteras Island.
Oh.
So yeah. That's like old shipwreck country, pirate country. Mm-hmm. Yep. That's where Blackbeard the pirate did his last stand.
Mm-hmm.
And they have, I learned, tons of traditions about ghosts and spirits there, right? Like there's really rich folklore there. And I was visiting a school, as I'm prone to do.
You do that a lot?
Sharing about books and trying to be a cheerleader for reading and stuff. And I happened to bring up, I don't know why, it's not like a standard thing on my question, but I think because I'd almost heard a couple ghost stories, I was like, who here has ghost stories or has seen a ghost or someone in their family saw a ghost? It was like 3/4 of the class. It was like I asked who likes ice cream. You know what I mean? And to me, that was interesting. And for example, one of the stories that I heard repeated was that in Hatteras Island, before a storm, there would be a gray man who would appear on the beach and warn of the coming storm. And often people would then turn around and he'd kind of disappear. And I heard the story enough that I was like, well, I think this counts as folklore. So I put a gray man into Fablehaven 5. I put their gray man basically right. into Fablehaven 5. But aside from putting it into Fablehaven 5 was just the wheels turning on. Yeah, how much does this happen? How real are ghosts? Are they spirits from the other side? What's going on? It's just, it fills me with questions. And not all of them are answered.
I know you're religious.
Yeah.
And I'm religious. How does the whole ghost question work with that? Like, I believe in life after death.
Sure, me
right?
too.
Yeah. Absolutely believe in life after death. Do I then believe in ghost stories about someone lingering because of unfinished business and things? I don't think that I do, right?
And that's the exact question right. I'm asking. Mm-hmm. Like it's the exact question. Because if in my heart of hearts, I really do think that we have spirits inside of us that yes. will live on after death. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean that you could have a haunted house. That doesn't mean that mm-hmm. ghosts linger or haunt or... But to me, it also doesn't mean that maybe that doesn't happen sometimes.
Right.
Who knows? Maybe they can choose to linger if they so choose. I truly don't feel like I have an answer, but it's a mystery mm-hmm. that intrigues me.
Intrigues you. Yeah. This one, like you said, is different from all the others. In that this is one that is wrapped up in religion.
Yeah,
right. And wrapped up in, and I think of all the things on this, like you would say, most people that I would talk to, religious people, would be like, yes, I felt an ancestor watching over me. My mother was there. You hear that?
Like a spiritual presence.
Yes,
was
spiritual
there.
Presence. Yeah, yeah. This is a thing that most people I know would say, yeah, I've had that experience.
And they wouldn't call that a ghost.
They probably wouldn't.
In the spooky way, right?
Yes.
They wouldn't talk about, oh, there was this ghost and it freaked me out. It would have been more like, oh, I had this good feeling. And
my sister-in-law, Kathy, who is occasionally on the channel, now she likes ghosts. She goes on ghost tours and all of those sorts of things. She watched the ghost hunting shows and things like that, which I have never gotten into any of that that end of it.
I did a ghost tour at mm-hmm. the Green River, Wyoming Library. Mm-hmm. I was there doing a visit, and they said, we do ghost tours here. Do you want to do mm-hmm. a ghost tour after you're done? So I had this private ghost tour from these librarians, and to put things kind of briefly, it was weird.
Mm.
It was weird. They had that, often they use these little devices that mm-hmm. it reads electromagnetic fields, mm-hmm. right? Same thing if you put it by a wire in the wall, it'll mm-hmm. read the field from the wire. And there were some places where we weren't by wires, and that thing was going nuts in ways that it got creepy. It got creepy enough that I was like, I don't know, I can't explain it. And it was sort of weird. And these librarians had tons of stories, really interesting stories. All of them, they said it's almost an initiation at their library that when you're back in the stacks, you'll hear your name whispered at some point. And they had a rule at their library that they couldn't stay after a certain time, alone. You weren't allowed to be there alone, because there'd been too many weird things that had happened when people were there alone. And so it was enough things that was another kind of piece in the puzzle mm-hmm. that made my wheels get turning, you know?
If I go and they whisper my name, I'll be like, you're looking for the wrong one.
You want Mull. Find Mull. Bug him.
Coincidentally, kind of, you mentioned Carolina, North Carolina.
Yeah, Outer Banks.
My fourth one on my list is Lost Colony of Roanoke, which is
that
region.
Oh, that's a good one. Yeah,
That's another one that just always fascinated me. For those who don't know, right, there was a small colony, 100-something settlers, that early days of settling, Europeans settling, in North America. There was the kind of leader of the colony, John White or something like that. He was called back because of a big war thing happening, Spanish Armada stuff. Leaves his family with them, comes back, everybody's gone.
Yeah, just gone.
Just gone. Just gone. There's one word, I can't remember what it was, written on a post. I think it was related to one of the Native American tribes or another location. Actually, I think it was another location, like another another location, just written on a post. They don't know why. The only clue of what happened to them, and they're just gone. Now, you know, I don't think that aliens came and got them. I think they probably had some sort of issue, but I'd be curious to know. Was it involved in the Native Americans? Was it just like hurricane comes through that, you know,
washes away the evidence?
I mean, they had to evacuate because of that, and then, you know, what happened to them? Like, how do 100 and whatever people just vanish?
It's one thing if you find the bodies.
Yes.
It's the not finding the bodies leaves. Yes. Question marks, I guess, for hundreds of years, right?
Yeah. I really like that one. I actually, for a while, you guys are going to hate me for this, but I was, for a while, was going to have the Second Arithmetist novel deal with that, and then I threw that out the window. One of the reasons why the Second Arithmetist novel's taken forever is I threw that whole concept. But it was going to be Lost Colony focused for a little while.
Oh, neat.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you liked that focus, and then it just wasn't coming together. Huh?
It wasn't coming together. And that book has just been, it's a different thing entirely. So kind of actually playing into this a little bit is yours, Lost Treasures.
Yeah.
Your last one, Lost Treasure. What do you mean by Lost Treasures?
So there's just legends, right?
Uh-huh.
About lost, like the Lost Dutchman Mine in Arizona, or like, I have some friends that have gone out and tried to find treasure, right? Like they hunt around with metal detectors and see what they can find, and to me it's just intriguing what might be hidden around the world, and why is there these things like the Lost Dutchman Mine that feels like everyone kind of knows about, but no one can really nail down if it's real or not real. And I don't know, to me that's the kind of mystery that fascinates me.
Do you get into the whole like buried pirate treasure sort of mysteries and things like that? Yeah,
I know a guy who's gone off and found some treasure like scuba diving and stuff.
Right.
Negotiates with governments and splits the proceeds when he finds stuff, and it's pretty interesting.
I mean, this one is also different in that this is the one on the list that you can point at and say this is realistically happening and being proven true even today.
Yeah.
People are finding old fortunes, like, you know, there are a bunch of coins found in a bog in Britain, right? Just not that long ago. I mean, it was decades ago, but still dug out a bunch of gold coins.
Yeah.
And it's like, wow, these were just in a bog. That's cool.
Like,
what else is
possible
in the bog, right?
Yeah.
Right? And things like that. Like, and there's all these, there's like reputable stories of ships that sank. We don't know where exactly. We can't even find like the Malaysian airline black box that got shot down in a modern era, which is another one of these mysteries. So finding where all this gold went.
Old treasure ships coming back from the Americas or something, right? Yeah, it makes my wheels turn. And then there's even just stuff like the Oak Island stuff. Like, do you know, are you aware of that?
I don't even have any idea what that is.
So there's like, there's a reality show, like Curse of Oak Island or something, right? And it's these brothers that have been trying to dig up treasure on this little island off the coast of Nova Scotia.
Mm-hmm.
And they bought the island because they were so intrigued and trying to find this treasure. But the story dates back to the 1700s, where some kids went along the beach, found a depression in the sand, started digging, got 10 feet down and hit planks, which would just intrigue any human, I think, on Earth. They break the planks, they go down another 10 feet and find another story of planks, like another floor / ceiling, right? They come back when they're older. They go down through nine levels of planks every 10 feet, right? They get down like around 70 feet at that level of planks. They find like a gold necklace. Like around 90, they find a stone with like codes on it, right? They get a little deeper and they trigger a booby trap that like funnels in water from the sea and fills the whole thing up. And for 200 years, people have been trying to get to the bottom of this thing. And it's just such a mess with all the seawater and stuff that no one's ever succeeded.
Wow.
There's 8 seasons of a show of guys trying to get to the bottom. They've dumped millions of dollars into it and they can't get to the bottom. But for me, that's intriguing. I could have been that guy, perhaps. Because like, it's, if I found planks and then 10 feet lower planks, yeah, I'd want to get down till I found whatever was at the bottom, you know?
My fifth one is, I'm going to pronounce this wrong, the Voynich manuscript. Do you know what this is?
I don't know this one. Good. Yeah,
oh,
tell
this,
me.
This one's cool. So 1400s, I think early 1400s, there's a manuscript we found that was carbon dated back to then that has no title page, no listed author, and is written entirely in a made-up script. It's an illuminated manuscript with pictures, and it's got and no one can translate it. No one knows why it was written. Why in the 1400s? Like, if you came across it now, you'd be like, oh, it's, you know, some guy who likes Klingons, created their own conlang and whatnot. In the 1400s, somebody did this.
Right.
Completely their own made-up script. Maybe, we don't even know if the script means anything. It could just be weird symbols that weren't actually making a conlang. It could be a cipher. It could be, like lots of theories. People are like, oh, this is secretly like the Book of the Dead or something, or this is like, you know, the Necronomicon or whatnot. Other people are like, oh, this is just an art exercise where they were just doing interesting what writing looks like. But the effort it takes to write and illuminate an entire manuscript is just mind-boggling to kind of modern times, and somebody created one, and we have no idea why. I love it. It's one of my favorite things of all time.
Yeah, that would be fun to one day know, was it a gag?
Yeah.
Was it a mystery?
It one of these monks is like, I'm going to play a prank on everyone. They think I'm doing the Bible. They're going to come along and they'll be like, what is this? Like, oh yeah, it's the Bible written in, you know, this language of these people I met once or something like that.
I did a semi-equivalent back in college where when I would get bored, I had a binder that had some of my different classes, and I just added a bullfighting class. And when I would get bored in class, I would write notes about my bullfighting class, and like anything I could think of about bullfighting, I'd put in, and diagrams of like cape work and like grace under pressure being very important. And like, I just took the notes only so that maybe someone would look and go, wait, do you have a bullfighting class? And no one ever did.
No one ever did. Yeah. Well, that's tragic.
It was just for my own entertainment, but I used it as an anecdote just now.
Well. Thank you, Brandon, for coming.
Yeah,
it's always fun to hang out with you. We often, sometimes at conventions, we're at FanX right now, get the Brandon and Brandon show, where we just kind of do this in front of an audience.
Yes.
Now you guys get to see us do it sitting in chairs here. You have a new book coming out.
I do. So I wrote this series, Fablehaven, right? Mm-hmm. Which is a brother and sister having adventures on secret wildlife parks for magical creatures. And it was a complete series of 5 books until I realized I didn't really finish the character journey of my character Seth, which is one of the 2 main characters. And I also had left a bunch of loose ends. And so I've written a sequel series called Dragon Watch, which really now together as 10 books kind of tells the whole Fablehaven story. It turns Fablehaven 1 into first half. Dragon Watch is now the second half. And having recently finished Dragon Watch book 5, which is the finale, I think the second half is the better half, the stronger half.
We get better and better, hopefully, as writers with each book.
Knock on wood, but I'm proud of it, and I'm excited about it. And so, yeah, if you haven't tried Dragon Watch and you liked Fablehaven, read those Dragon Watch books. Or
when's the fifth one officially?
Dragon Watch book 5 comes out October, I think, 23rd.
Okay.
I believe. If I'm wrong, I'm only barely wrong.
We'll try to launch this sometime around then.
That would be great. Yeah, that would be great. I could use any bump so that people know that it's happening. So.
All right. We need to go out to dinner sometime. It's been too long.
Yeah,
it's
I would like that very much.
It's been since before COVID the last time we went out to dinner. So.
Yeah, and you got to get to know her, Lynn. She's terrific. She really is.
So, awesome. Thank you, Brandon. We're going to do one of these because, you know, whatever.
Such are the times.
Yeah, such are the times. Have a good con. Thank you for spending some time with us.
Yeah, my pleasure.